Thank you for inviting me here. Hope you have a nice lunch. It looks very tasty. And I hope to add some of bit of our knowledge at the same time. So in this presentation, I will go over the way of how we work at CERN. It's quite some physics contents in here about what we do, how we do it, and why we do it in certain ways. And along the way, you see how we use computing to do our physics research. So first, the outline. I will give you an introduction to CERN, the LHC, the detectors, and the results that we obtain with those with that equipment. Then I will describe the process, how we go from a detector to physics results that you see that are being published and that you hear about. The data taking, the reconstruction, simulation, and physics analysis are the different steps that we go through to get to the results. And then a bit about the computing, the computer centers, the infrastructure, which are an interesting but not the exciting part. And then a summary. So CERN, it's an international organization close to Geneva. It was founded in 1954 by a bunch of very visionary scientists who decided we needed one specific location and one specific area where we can do pure science. You know, it was after the war, and they want to combine and make an international environment for this. So initially, there were 12 member states that founded CERN. It provides facilities for fundamental research in particle physics. So CERN stands for Centre Européen pour la Recherche Nucléaire. It's for nuclear research. So in the beginning, many people were afraid that it was for atomic research. But it's for pure, peaceful, fundamental particle physics research, and has always been. Currently, there are 22 member states. It's slightly growing. Last year, Romania joined. There's a budget of 1 billion Swiss francs per year that's paid by the 22 member states as a share of their national products. There are about 3,360 staff, fellows, and students and apprentices working there, working basically on the infrastructure. The 2,500 staff members are the ones who are paid to make the accelerator, the computer center, the buildings, the infrastructure, and all that, and make that available to the visiting scientists. And then there are 11,000 users worldwide. They come from any country in the world. There's not a single country that is not allowed to send scientists there. There's no politics in that sense. And the 11,000 users come from typically universities from any country in the world, and they work together shoulder to shoulder to do the experiments, to analyze the data, and work on general knowledge that enhances our common understanding. So it's science for peace, basically. What is a spin-off? Of course, you know, the theories and all that is nice. We verify the latest the physics theories and all that. But CERN, of course, you know, building the infrastructure and all that, we have spin-offs that sometimes are useful. So Tim Berners-Lee was very successful with his little ID, you know, that we all use everywhere now. And so there are more technologies in the area of cryogenics, in very cold or very high, very specialized vacuum technologies that are developed at CERN to be able to do to build the accelerator and things like that. And the spin-off technologies are very interesting, you know, can be used directly in industry. And are the intellectual property, the IP, is freely available to all countries and to everybody who wants to use them. So that is the interesting thing. So this is the area where we work. It's a very nice environment. It's the Geneva Lake, the Mont Blanc, highest top of Europe. And here's the accelerators, 27 kilometers in circumference, with four experiments, ATLAS, ALICE, CMS, and LHCb. This is Geneva Airport here. So this is the basic environment. So the Large Hadron Collider is the biggest machine, the science instrument I think mankind ever made. It's a proton-proton and lead-lead collider. Lead ions can be collided in a tool. It's 27 kilometer circumference. Run one of the machine when it was started was in 2010. It started before, but then we had an accident and a piece of the accelerator was ripped apart because of a faulty soldering welding point that had a bit too high resistance, and the cryogenics became warmed up and the thing exploded. But in 2010, we successfully started with 3.5 terabytes on 3.5 tera electron volt beams. And this continued to 2011. After that, there was an upgrade where we went to 4 TV beams on 4 TV beams. So there's 8 TV in total energy in the point of interaction. Run 2 started in May 2015 and will end this year. In a few months, it will be over. It has been a run of 6.5 on 6.5 tera electron volt, 13 TeV collisions in center of mass point. The more confidence we got in the machine, the higher we could go with the energy. The design energy of the machine, the top maximum is about 14 TeV. So we are currently running very, very near the maximum design specs, which is an enormous achievement on a machine of this complexity. So of course, it's the world's most powerful particle accelerator. Also, the beam pipe inside, this is empty as outer space, 10 to the 11 millibar vacuum. So the vacuum technology is amazing to get the beam pipe. The beam pipe actually is in the middle of the blue pipe that you see there. The blue pipe is a cryogenics installation. The beam pipe is, extremely empty, because if there would be some gas inside, gas is of course protons, you would hit them anywhere with a beam and you would get a lot of loose beam and you never get nice collisions head on in where you want them. So the having a very empty beam pipe is extremely important. Same time, it's one of the coldest places in the universe. The beam is, the magnets are cooled to 1.9 Kelvin. As you know, outer space is 2.7 Kelvin, it's the 3-degree background radiation. So we are colder than space in that sense, and the cryogenics is inside the blue container. And then it's at the same time the hottest place in the universe, because when we collide lead on lead ions, we have about 5.5 trillion Kelvin energy temperature in the center of the collision. Of course, it's an extremely small surface, but it's about 30 million times hotter than the sun core and 5,000 times hotter than a supernova collapsing to a neutron star. So the energy, the temperature is amazing. It's just a fraction after the Big Bang, that type of temperature we can make in a quark-gluon plasma when lead on lead is collided. So in that sense, it's an absolute amazing instrument that has been designed and developed and operated. So this LHC run schedule, this is where we started in 2010 with 7 TV, then to 8 TV, then we have 2 years, 2.5 years of 2 years of shutdown to upgrade all kind of weld points and be sure that we can go to a higher energy. Then we went to 13 TV, and now we'll have a shutdown here in from 19 and 20. Next year there's a CERN open day where everybody can visit downstairs in the accelerator, because normally in the short shutdowns, it's radioactive, and in the 2 years, after 1 year, it cools down and you can enter and visit. So if you come to Geneva next year, it will be in a good moment. Then there will be 3 years run on 14 TV with more intensity, so we can pack more particles per in the beams. So you get more collisions at the same time, about 2 times more than we had last year's. And then we have a big shutdown in 2024 to half of 2026 for an upgrade to what we call the high luminosity LHC, where we go to a factor 10 more particles in dense particles. So for that, a lot of things have to be upgraded to be able to pack so many more particles in the accelerator. And then a whole new regime starts. And you see, we work with very long timelines. So this already planned and funding for this has been agreed already by all the member states who fund CERN. So there are four large detectors, like I said. You have the Atlas, CMS, ALICE, and LHCb detectors. Atlas and CMS look very much alike, a bit in some numbers, 150 million channels of electronic channels that are sensitive to particles that pass by. It's 25 meters in diameter, 46 meters in length, 7,000 tons about. You have 3,000 scientists, of which 1,000 grad students who work together on this machine. There's no outside company who is doing management or supervision or whatever. It is just managed and directed and constructed and built and operated by those scientists from all over the world. And they're not specifically CERN scientists. Yeah. No, so I will go a bit more in detail. CMS and Atlas are measuring exactly the same. And they are there to verify that, to keep each other honest. If both have to measure, for example, find the Higgs, both have to find the Higgs. If one would only have seen it, it would not have been announced as a discovery. So they're orthogonal to each other, but they have both, can measure all the generic events. Atlas and LHCb are, or ALICE and LHCb are different detectors. ALICE is tuned for heavy iron for the lead-lead collisions, where many more particles come out, so it has to have a different data acquisition system, etc., etc. And LHCb is another detector that is measuring a lot of forward particles that come out on a low angle, and it's an asymmetric detector and very specifically tuned to measure very small effects of the standard model. Okay, so the LHC experiments take about 72 petabytes of data last year, and the total over accumulated over all the years is about 700 petabytes at the moment. So you have detector online systems. So the rate of the beam sparsing, the bunches, the beams are actually bunches of protons, about 3,000 bunches, I think, per beam. With a rate of 40 megahertz, they cross each other. And several petabytes per second of data, this is, for example, Atlas, gets a petabyte of per second of data about. So the level one trigger, it's a hardware trigger, filters this down to about 100 kilohertz rate of events. So all the ones that are very trivial events that we've seen billions of times, we are not recording again, so we throw them away. And then there's a high-level trigger system, which typically in software, which filters down to 1 kilohertz, and that is written to disk. And that's with a rate of 1 to 10 gigabytes per second is the data streamed. When the experiments run, it's 24/7, the data is being stored. So this is the current system where we use different triggers to filter down. That works, of course, fine if we look for something that's specified or is predicted by theory, for theory predicted Higgs. So we look in a certain range for Higgs, looking for some specific signatures that the theory describes. And we can make triggers that throw away everything else. But in the future, the theory currently is not predicting anything. We don't have any theory that predicts something new. And we still want to run and we look for something new. So we cannot trigger on something that we know is described by theory. Now we have to start accepting everything and then later see if in the data some new events, something new comes, appears. And then the theoreticians have to see if they can match a theory explaining what we see. So in the future, the triggers will be highly reduced and we will stream much, much more data directly record much more data and store much more data. In the next round. So this is the center of CMS. One of my colleagues was standing here. We were one night down in the underground area. It's about 100 meters deep under the ground. All the experiments are. The accelerator is also 100 meters underground, of course. This is the CMS detector. The inside Atlas is this side. It's so enormous that there's only a very small angle where you can take photos from. This the human size is next to it. This is the ALICE detector with a guy working in the center. And this all scaffolding goes away. And those red doors are closed to make it completely close to magnetic field inside. And LHCb, I don't have a photo of because it doesn't look nice on the photo. But I mean, if the LACB people hear me say that, I'm in big problems. But we have many results so far. I mean, the most spectacular, of course, being the result on 4th of July 2012, when we announced a discovery of a Higgs-like particle. At that time, we didn't dare to call it a Higgs because we didn't have enough information. We had what we call 5-sigma certainty that it was a new particle, but we didn't know for sure if it was compatible with being in Higgs. This was during that announcement, the two, Professor Higgs and Professor Englert, who had at the same time came up with the same theory, but it was, we called it the Higgs particle, but it was two theoreticians who came to the idea. In March 2013, we agreed that it's finally, that's really the Higgs boson. It had all the characteristics that was predicted in theory. And in October 2013, they got the Nobel Prize directly afterwards. And CERN was explicitly mentioned as being instrumental in there. I mean, CERN cannot get a Nobel Prize because it has to be given to a person and not to an organization. The Peace Prize, yes, but not science prizes. So how do we get from the result, from the collisions in the detectors to the plots and the graphs and the analysis that you see? So physics results are not just finding a single golden event. You see the one event with, that must be the Higgs, or a few of them. But it is basic an analysis, these are Higgs events, but you only find later. The basic analysis that you make statistical comparisons of the experiment with theoretical predictions. And you need billions of events and billions of theoretical predictions, but we simulate those and see if they match. So here you see the kind of events, the peaks that we see, the with the experimental data. You have the MC data, the Monte Carlo data. That's the data that's generated if you make a simulation of your whole experiment and you put as input you give the theory, and then you see if the theory and the data match, and if they match, your theory is good. Your experimental data is always good, so you cannot say my data is wrong because it doesn't fit the theory. It's always the other way around. So that's what happens here. So and then a discovery in our world is agreed when it has a 5-sigma confidence level, which translates in a chance in 1 in 3.5 million to be wrong. So that's our requirement to be sure or feeling confident that something is in discovery. So what is a theory? For example, one theory is a standard model that till now extremely well describes what we see experimentally. And it has different components. It's all described here. The different parts of the, it describes the different couplings and the quarks and the leptons that we see, etc. And this theory matches very well the experimental data we see. So this is currently the only theory that we have, but we know that's not really good enough because we cannot calculate, for example, particle masses in high precision. It's the theory doesn't give is precise enough to determine the masses of particles. So there are components missing in this one, and which ones we don't know at the moment. So the different parameters that we have, coupling constants, masses, and it predicts cross sections. For example, how often a particle decays in certain other particles. That's what cross sections are, or branching ratios and lifetimes. How long does a particle live? That's all predicted by the theory. So those coupling constants come out if you calculate. They can be tuned. So you tune them to match the experimental data, that is what those constants are. So then the standard model has a number of those constants, and the better the theory, the fewer of those constants you have, the fewer twiddling you can do. Ideally, you have zero. It's just the theory describes exactly how it is. So the detector. So like I said, you have 150 million elements. 40 million bunch crossings per second, about 1 petabyte per second of internal data rate. And then we have to data reduction. We suppress the electronic noise, decide to read out and save an event or throw it away with the trigger, and build the event. So that's all done online data system. So for each event, this is done. And that we do at a rate of about 1 kilohertz and 2.5 gigabyte per second data rate, like I said, on average. And then we do a comparison of the theory with experiment, where we the observables we define which one can we see the physics quantities that are sensitive to in the theory, and we calculate statistically these observables over a large number of events that are recorded. So that's how basically that's the process, and then you get again the picture. So the analysis flows detect or trigger, then do reconstruction. That is where you reconstruct the tracks. So you see from all the electronic signals you get from the 3D space points, you make the tracks, and those space points are very close together, so it's very tricky to make it good. So this, the reconstruction, is very brute force, long processing stage, just on normal CPUs, nothing special. And at the end, you do physics analysis, which is basically data mining. This is what we call it, what people call now big data. The analysis of trying to find the needle in the haystack is happening here. So here we reconstruct the event and the candidates. Here we select the events, we calculate observables, and we cut on them. It's like I want to see events with so many particles, in certain direction, with energy in certain energy, etc. And then we do it with the theory. We do exactly the same, where we start with the theoretical data. We simulate it, Monte Carlo simulations. We throw dice all the time. Is particle created? Does particle decay, etc. And all those chances are determined by the standard model. Here we create an output that is identical to this output, and this data goes in the same chain of analysis as the same software for each experiment as the real data. So we can have those two chains in parallel, and we see, and then we can compare the results. So where we compare the experiment and theory. So detector and trigger, so proton and photon collisions create numerous secondary particles in the direction point, and these secondary particles must be, that's what we detect. The incoming, of course, we don't care, but what's coming out. So all the detectors that you see are basically built up in shells. So you measure different properties of the collision. So starting at the center, you have the collision, and there you want to measure very precisely the particles that come directly out of the interaction point. So you have a very fine detector. It's often a silicon pixel detector. We have basically a camera silicon pixels. And the particles going through there make a very fine, you can very precisely reconstruct the tracks that go through there in very fine detail. And this kind of is very fast readout also, so that's used for triggering. Then you have detection of photon, then you have detection of more slower detection of tracks that happens in this layer. Next layer, you have calorimeters, where you measure energy depositions. So you have an electromagnetic calorimeter. That's the lighter particles, electrons, photons, they make showers in this calorimeter. It's a heavy material, and the particles impinge on it and create light that is being recorded in the calorimeter. And then we have a hadronic calorimeter. It's for the heavier particles, like the neutrons and the protons that go through this calorimeter because they are too energetic. And this is huge iron detectors with interspersed sensitive volumes. And you see the showers, what we call them showers, are recorded. And if you see a shower, you know it is either from a proton or a neutron. And if it's from a neutron, the track is not curved because we are in a magnetic field. And the magnetic field makes the curvature. So proton is curved and neutron is straight. You see shower straight, and you don't see from a neutron anything in the tracking detectors because it doesn't ionize any gas in the other detectors. And you have a muon, it's a particle that goes through everything without interacting, because that's the properties, and will hit only some detectors in the outside, called muon spectrometers. If you have any signal there, it must be a muon. And neutrinos go totally undetected. So they pass through and they don't leave any trace, and we only know their existence because there's a little energy mismatch. If you calculate the energy of all the particles, then the escaping neutrinos give the little missing energy. And there you know how much, neutrino came that way, went that way. So this is the general structure of all particle detectors. They have basically like this, and they vary in the techniques they use here, the different calorimeters, the different type of detector, detecting elements, the gas, the tracking detectors have different architectures and all that. So you tune those, and if you want to measure more specifically one thing or another thing. So then the next step, you have the raw data, you have all the space points, and now you want to make the event that you see, like, you know, like the nice pictures with all the part tracks going out. So you need to do the reconstruction. So this is basically from the space points to identify particles. So you do first tracking is in the detectors where you have the space points. You find the part of the charged particle through the detectors, and you can there determine the momentum, the charge, point of closest approach to the interaction point. So, by the way, the radius of the curvature, and the calorimeter reconstruction, you can find the energy deposition in the calorimeters from the charged and neutral particles. And you can determine the energy deposit location and directions, so you know the origin of the particles going there. You combine then the different parts in the reconstruction, and you can then see which one are electrons, photons. You can identify them. You can see which were the muons, and you can see which were the jets in the calorimeters. So this identifies then an event. And this is done for all billions of events. So this processing is quite time consuming. It's 10, 20 seconds per event, so which is already short, but it's very long for billions of events. And this is done all over the world where the data is distributed to. So for example, this is what a picture of space points, and then the algorithm has to find, for example, the different tracks in this thing. And here, for example, the 50 GeV track is almost straight track, because high energy. And this has to be done for thousands of particles, you know, so the track finding algorithms are extremely tuned to do this. These things are not done currently with machine learning or, you know, identification of like image identification. It is it's all standard good old algorithms, Kalman filtering algorithms to find those tracks. So I mentioned a few times simulation. Simulation is the part that takes most computing in particle physics. So we have to simulate, you know, if you have, you have to simulate about 1.5-2 times more events than you have real events to understand your statistical and systematic errors. In so you have, we have to make enormous amount of simulated events. Simulating event takes, depending on how detailed you do it, takes much more time, for example, than reconstructing events. So we have enormous farms and computer centers only doing simulation. Simulation of certain collisions, certain type of collisions, certain events. You don't simulate events that are not interesting. So you simulate mostly events that are interesting, and later you compare it to, you inject the non-interesting ones to get a good sample. So why simulation? Of course, to compare the observables, with expectations from the theoretical models, which leads to the physical results. But also in the design phase of the detector. So before you make a detector, you say, oh, I would like to use this gas and that gas, and I want to have these parameters to be able to have an even better separation of particles. So you simulate this detector model. You construct the geometry. You put in the gas or the sensitive volumes, the detector system, and you shoot particles through it. and you see how good you are in separating, for example, things. So we know all the material properties. To be able to do that, you must know in detail all the material properties of the gases to which you, for example, drift and ionize, et cetera, et cetera. We simulate also to optimize trigger settings. So since, you know, before building, you know, you cannot just build it and then do something and then see and then tune it. So we do all this tuning with with the simulation. Optimize the trigger settings, tune the analysis selections. To see, you know, how to best analyze it. We make first selections before we have the real data on the simulated data. So basically, you can do the whole chain. Like I said, you do the analysis, can be tuned here. You can estimate the background and systematic errors that can pollute to the signal, and estimate efficiency and resolution and fake data rates. So that is all handled by simulation. So we basically, before we built the detector, we think we understand it very well. Then we built it, and then you take the real data, and then you start comparing if the simulation is really good. So you can then tune the simulation a bit more and see how that it really fits the data. So the first step is physics. So you simulate the physics interaction, like a proton-proton collision. You know, it's the basic physics. You see the Feynman diagram of this process. You have the two quarks from the proton-proton, and you, for example, here is a process where you get an E plus E minus out, and it's one of the processes you simulate. And what you get out is basically a four-factor of secondary particles. The incoming are the Q and the two quarks, and the outgoing are the direction of the XYZ and the momentum and the energy of the outgoing particles. That are the four vectors that you record. And you do that of the millions of proton collisions you have. So that's the input for your simulation. Then you simulate the detector, like I said. You track those generated initial four vectors. You track to the detector, to the material, and you simulate basically a whole detector. And we have one huge program doing that. It's called Gion4. You find it here. It is a toolkit where you can describe your detector geometry. You can describe the sensitive volumes, the gases it's made of, the walls are made of certain materials. You describe everything. It helps you setting all this up. It then can display the whole thing in 3D. You can look at it. And then you can say what physics processes are taking place. It will create them and track them to the detector. This program is also used, for example, to see the effect of radiation on astronauts. You know, the cosmic radiation, and we use Gion4 is being used by NASA to see how much what goes to astronauts, how much radiation do they get. How do the radiation impinge on the body? It's a bag of water, you know. So that's it's being used there. So it's very CPU intensive, and we do it even. You know, it's about 60% of all our CERN computing or Einstein physics computing is in simulation. Electronics is also simulated, so everything is really simulated. We have to understand everything. So even the reaction of the AC-DC converters and all that. Everything that you have is simulated. Then the physics analysis, the last step. That is where we get really the physics out of the data. So you have different types of physics analysis. You search for new particles, new phenomena that are not described by any theory. It's basically limited by statistics. The more events you have, the more you have the chance that something starts showing up in a histogram. Negative results are very important too, nothing found. So we have theories like supersymmetry was a theory that was probably, if you have studied physics or you heard about supersymmetry, standard model, and you have supersymmetry, it's an extension to the standard model. That describes and predicts a whole series of supersymmetric particles to our current known particles, like the electron, positron, etc. And this theory was also from the beginning 60s, and over the years, it was people just took it for truth. It was just to be discovered, but it must be true. I mean, the theory is beautiful. It extends the standard model, and it should be there. And we will find whole sea of new particles that are predicted by it. But we found nothing. So this whole theory is with 99, with, you know, with several sigma, not true. And, you know, people have worked for 40 years, 50 years on this theory, and books have been written and students have learned it, but it's just not true. So you cannot argue, yeah, maybe a bit true, or we will find, no, it's finished. Hundreds of theoreticians worked for 40 years on it, and that was it. So negative results are extremely important. So if we now look, currently we look for, after the Higgs, we have not found anything. We look, we keep looking, and we don't see anything new. So that's a bit, you know, for the big, for the you know, for the people looking from outside, it looks like a failure, or it looks like, well, why are they doing all this effort? But intellectually, for us, it's very important. We find nothing. That's a big news. You know, we, you know it's really super exciting to find nothing. You know, because because it's knowledge. You know, we know now there is nothing after this Higgs till now that we found. It might be also that there is something, but with the current trigger systems, we throw all the nice new things away because we think it's maybe something that's hidden in the data that we think that we know everything about. So that's why we now look in trigger-free systems. Anyway, so there's a lot of the idea of negative results is very important in our world. And precision measurements that are, for example, LHCb is doing precision management measurements on standard model coupling constants and very specific parameters. And you know, they collect billions of data points and verify, you know, standard model in certain areas to very high precision. So physics workflow is basically you start with the output for the reconstruction. You apply then event selection based on reconstructed object quantities. You calculate new information like masses of combination of particles, you know, groups of particles in one direction. The event selection is designed to improve the signal, you know, to background in your event sample. Then we estimate the efficiency of the selection, the uncertainty, how much error do we have in the selection, what's the background we get. We can also use simulation for these uncertainties to estimate, you know, depending on how we believe the theory is good there. And then we make the final plot, you know, comparing data to theory. We make fits, you know, the latest and most complicated fit technologies are used, fitting technologies are used. To find, you know, to make extremely precise fits on the very low data bumps that we've seen in the histograms. So it's very very advanced statistical analysis we do here. So the output of the reconstruction is large, it's order of petabytes. Simulation is about the same size as the reconstruction. So the experiments have defined the reduced data sets that are used for the analysis, both general and specific channels. So if you are doing a PhD on some specific aspect, you don't need the whole data set, but only data that shows events that match your data set, that match your the type of physics you look at. And sometimes the final steps are based on even more reduced private data sets that fit to your laptop and things like that. Okay. One of the tools that I used for data analysis is called ROOT. Which is a tool we developed starting in 95, which is done and used to store data, do the data processing, data analysis, and data visualization. Basically, it takes care of the whole data handling chain for physics data. So it's written in C++. Line one was written in December 94, and now it's about 3 million lines of code. And it's used, adopted in Heinze physics and quite a number of other sciences, but also in industry, in financial industry, for example, pharma industry also. Currently, 700 petabytes of data in root format is stored on the LHC computer grid. It's all the data produced by the LHC experiments. It fits and fits and parameter estimations for the discoveries of the Higgs have been done with Root. All the analysis and the statistics modules have been used by, were provided by Root. And thousands of Root plots are in scientific publications. It's open source, you can find it here. And it can be used for analyzing anything, any traffic densities, anything where you have data that fits in a tabular format, you can easily import and analyze in with very high precision. So I go quickly over it because I have more and I run a bit behind. You can read this. We provide anything for histograms, graphing trees, everything. It has an own data store, a self-described file format. Row-wise and column-wise storage are supported. You can stream data in it, but you can also store it in columnar format for very efficient analysis, like current modern data formats are doing. We have a lot of statistical tools for rich modeling of statistical and statistical inference. A lot of MAT functions, very powerful. We have a C++ interpreter, which is quite unique. It's called Kling. It's part of the LLVM suite. You can download it and use it standalone. It gives you a prompt, which allows you to type C++. It can interpret a C++ program. You can type C++ lines line by one, like if you, with Apple Swift, you have, for example, a prompt and you can do that, or like Python. So it's a full interpreter, but of C++. It's jitted on the fly, so it runs machine level performance, not like Python, things like that. So this is the heart of the Root system. Currently it's an LLVM based product, so it's extremely developed by us. It's very solid. We have machine learning and deep learning technology in here. Performance-wise, equivalent to TensorFlow and other systems like that. We can display anything in 2D, 3D graphics, or even whole complicated detectors. We have a parallel analysis facility, and many more tools. And like I said, it can be used from the whole chain for the experiments. These are different experiments from raw data reconstruction, stored in reconstruction data, further processing, skimming, you get analysis formats, event selection, statistical treatment, and you get the images. All are stored in the root files, in the root format, which basically match C++ classes. So the data can be stored, of course, local or remote, et cetera, et cetera. And these are the plots that you can make with Root, and many, many more different ones. So computing, that's the last part of it. So, of course, we cannot, CERN has a computer center, but it's not large enough to do all the processing, the reconstruction, and all the simulation and the analysis. So CERN came after a lot of discussions in the 90s to a tiered model to do our computing. We have tier zero at CERN, where the raw data is taken and stored on mass storage on tape as the first main source. And after that, the raw data is copied to 11 different sites. Each have 1/11th of all the raw data that they also store on mass storage. And they have, they keep custodial copies of everything. So it's a backup basically of the CERN original raw data. And then we have more than 100 tier two centers. They're typically regional computing centers, a cluster of universities together who put their computers together to do to prepare the data for analysis. So the reconstruction is typically done on the tier one centers. And on the and the simulation is also done on those centers, and the analysis on the tier two centers in the end. So, like I said, the nature of the problem is that we have an enormous number of proton-proton collisions. The data for each collision is in the order of 1 to 10 megabytes, so it's very small. The very compact, the raw data. And the nice thing is that each collision is independent of the others, so you can very trivial make your processing parallel. You don't need the supercomputing that works hours on one event, but you have each core can do one run the whole program itself, and you have thousands of cores doing thousands of entire programs in parallel, because the input stream is all independent events. So there's no So in that sense, there's no supercomputing needed. We can do everything on PC architectures, very simple for the the simulations typically fit in 4 GB RAM. So even for an Atlas detector where you have 27 million volumes describing the detector, you can simulate it in quite compact memory. These were the typical architectures from current and 5 years ago, this kind of machines. Everything running Linux. And the calculations are mostly, strangely enough, integer calculations. A lot of if-then decisions and relatively few floating point intensive calculations. So last year we had 72 petabytes of new and raw data for the LHC experiments and 363 petabytes of all new data, so including simulation and other data. We need for that about 500,000 cores over all those tiers distributed. And the CERN computing computer centers gives you about 15% of this. We have a copy of the CERN computer center in Budapest and with very high bandwidth pipes connected as a kind of backup system. And all the other computing is done offsite. So for that, we invented a number of years ago, the WLCG is the worldwide LHC grid. So this is distributed computing infrastructure that provides the production and analysis for the LHC experiments. It's managed by and operated by a worldwide collaboration between the experiments and the participating computing centers. So the idea is, of course, logically, it's best to put everything in at CERN and one site. All data comes in there, you process everything, no data transport over the world. But sociological and for funding reasons, we could not do that. People, universities, funding agencies want their local student to work on the local, having the computers local and work on that locally. So that's why we came to this way. So this is the CERN computer center. So it's a relatively small computer center if you're used to the big ones that are provided by Facebook, Google, Apple. This is nothing really special. So one of the systems we have developed is a very large mass storage system. It's called EOS. It's also an open source system. It's the center of our distributed file system. It has an interface to what we call Castor, which is a storage manager, the interface to tape archive. Then it interfaces to the local cloud that we have, the OpenStack-based local cloud, and it exports to the worldwide computing grid. And there are about 50,000 readers and 6K writer jobs going on typically. So this is a bit of architecture of the system. So it's scaling up all the time. It's actively being developed to be using the latest technologies there's a part of a component is the file catalog and then the file system and backends for keys value stores, Ceph, and POSIX systems. And this is, for example, how it's being used. One exabyte of data written last year, 250 petabytes written. Number of disks is about 50,000 disks and 1,300 file servers that steer the disks. So anyway, so this is a bit of the local file system, and this is being now ported, installed on all the 11 and all the large computer centers. Bit of resource evolution for different CPU growth goes. After the shutdown of 2 years, we will double the data rates, etc. So you see, this is foreseen for increasing all the computers on the WLCG. Have to be doubled in disk size and CPU in the next few years. Here I will not say much. This is a collaboration we do at CERN, OpenLab. We look for new partners for companies that develop technology that we at CERN can use or need to make our task in the coming years doable. And we work in OpenLab. We we try to match the companies to groups at CERN who need to solve specific problems. And it's a very successful collaboration. These are the current partners, and of course, it would be nice if Samsung would be one of those partners, because I think both partners can offer a lot to each other here. So to summarize, physics results are statistical comparisons of observables with their theoretical predictions. That is the basic thing. The trigger and data acquisition, the reconstruction, simulation, and analysis is how we get there. That's the different steps. Very sophisticated algorithms are needed for reconstruction and data and the data analysis. Calibration and alignment must be very well controlled. The detailed simulation is, of course, key to the success, so a lot of that's done. And a single event is small and simple, but the computing scale is enormous. So anyway, thank you very much for your attention. I hope you enjoy.
Right, that was a wonderful presentation, something that you can't do at home, but we could admire from afar. We do have time for one or two questions, and then the speaker will be here for a while after that.
Hi, so you kind of already answered part of my question. It's about the triggering and the filtering. Do you know what is left out? Because we don't know what we don't know, right? Probably the next discovery is what is left out.
Right.
Do you know what percentage that is and what kind of compute power would be needed to process that?
Well, you see, we go from 40 megahertz to 1 kilohertz currently. So, of course, we can never write the full 40 megahertz. But we will reduce the triggers enormously to write much more than the 1 kilohertz. And so that's what we tried now to do, because we are afraid we throw away things that we later might regret. But we don't know any percentages. We don't know. We are totally in the blind. No. So the faster the systems, the intake systems are, you know, if you have much faster SSDs that can digest much more data, we can think of systems that record more. But then, of course, how big are the storage systems behind that have to store everything? That's to be seen. But that's a big challenge. Yeah.
One more question?
Those numbers are interesting. I know it's like a small city, that's what I know. But it's enormous. We have a special access point on the French and Swiss power grids. So next to it's amazing to see.
So where are we at finding ultimate theory, like which can explain macro and micro? I think you might have heard same question from other.
No, but we have, first of all, the standard model is amazing in how well and precise, you know, with many, many decimals behind the comma it can describe, it matches the experiment. But there are also things that are not matched completely at all. Like, why is the proton has a certain mass? You know, if you calculate it using standard model, you're 3% off. And so this uncertainty means that we don't know, you know, the theory is not good enough there. I gave a reference to a colleague of mine who's working on alternative theory that matches all the experimental data just almost as good as the standard model, in many cases better. And that measures, that describes the masses of the particles with per mil precision. So that might be a very exciting alternative, but it's a very early stage, and it's extremely speculative. But also, if that would be true, it would be extremely exciting. You know, so standard model is amazing that it works, but it is one of maybe several theories. You know, it's like Newton's gravity was a rough approximation, and Einstein's general relativity was the correction, the original, the on top of that. So the standard model can be also something reduced from that.
Question.
Yeah.
So there are
I know string theory is going on for many years, but they never come to something at the moment that we can measure. So it is string theory for, you know, supersymmetry. If you look it up, the Google supersymmetry, there are many textbooks that describe it in detail. And they that was theory that described the many particles that should exist just after the in heaviness, just after the Higgs. And we scanned there, we looked there, and we saw nothing. So this theory is not correct. String theory doesn't even describe any particles that we could measure. So it is like an economics theory almost. You can just invent something and, the truth is, if you say I don't believe it, then like the president, then, everybody can make up something, And, so the string theory is mathematically is fantastic. It's an pure mathematically seen is correct, but not physically.
Are there any attempts to reconcile particle physics that you do there at CERN with dark energy or dark matter and
try
to figure that out?
Yes, so I described only the LHC program, but we have a much richer program. I myself work also in another detector where we try to look for heavy and neutral particles that we can only see by decays that maybe happen once per year. So extremely rare cases, but that could describe or give hints to dark matter, dark energy that are, the current particles that we see from standard model is in less than 25% of what is out there, what describes So that is, so we have many smaller experiments going on that all look for something, a certain decay of or existence of a certain type of particle. And if we don't find it, we, like I said, a negative result is very positive because we can take out an area of the phase space in which something could happen, and we say, here it cannot happen because we don't see anything. So the more you can remove, by deduction, you can find the positive. So we have many experiments going on that look at very specific smaller things, and that are experiments of $100 million or something, which is peanuts compared to the, cost, so an atlas or something is also in the price of $500-600 million price, and the accelerator is we have a budget of $1 billion per year, but the accelerator is built over 10 years. So the thing is, the total cost is like $6-7 billion of the LHC. And those detectors are used, but a detector of 100 million could already give you an yes or no about a very important part of the theory. And we work actively on many of those. We have smaller experiments looking at those things.
All right, thank you very much. Please thank our speaker one more time.